I'm in Sweden, and as if it was meant to be, today is the 27th of February 2024. And yesterday, Hungary granted the final vote to have Sweden ascend to NATO. So let's check out what Gripen brings to the alliance, and we're going to do it in style.
Off we go. It will be just better and better. Take time to impact 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and we have the heat.
The Saab Gripen is Sweden's very own fighter jet, and it got a lot of attention in recent years, with the Russian 2022 full-scale invasion of Ukraine placing new emphasis on defense and security thinking in NATO countries. Countries like Finland and Sweden, previously neutral, applied for NATO membership. Both countries kept themselves on a Cold War footing, much more so than any other nation in Europe. From civil defense to home guard reservists, conscripts to decentralized and specialized operations, many of the lessons lost in NATO were kept on a low flame in the north. And no other platform shows this as clearly as the Gripen. First thing I did is get suited up and have a pre-flight briefing by no other than display pilot Andre Bulan Brandstrom of Riyadh 2023 and -3 +9G fame. We go through the stages of the flight, the safety procedures, and then I kit it up to get ready and have Andre take me to places.
Wetsuit, we wear these ones if the water is below 15 degrees Celsius for obvious reasons.
As I'm getting dressed, let me keep you in the loop what's going on here with this flight. Is this flight sponsored by Saab? The short answer to this is yes. Beyond this, however, I paid for all non-Gripen flight expenses, hotel, airline tickets, and what's in the margins by myself. To really keep that delimitation between me, this community, and a defense company like Saab clear. And this is possible thanks to Patreons and channel supporters that fund this channel.
The emergency beacon.
Yeah.
Life vest manual,
yeah.
But it's automatic.
Yeah.
Pistol, but it's fake.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
What do I do with the moose and the bears?
Yeah.
Oh, a fighter pilot.
Well, a pretend one. As a small, lightweight, powerful jet, Gripen is optimized for quick reaction alert, airspace defense, and anti-shipping and standoff capabilities. Designed around Swedish defense requirements, Gripen shines in dispersed operations, a type of operation that a lot of NATO air forces stopped doing at the end of the Cold War. There are many things NATO can learn from this alone, and I've got a full video on that already. Sweden brings about 80 new Gripen aircraft to NATO. The deterrent value of the alliance got a major boost with this, and the Gripen synergies and combat mass in the north with the emerging Norwegian, Danish, and Finnish F-35 fleet will be something to keep an eye on. Gripen has been NATO compatible for some time, and the Czech Republic and Hungary currently lease Gripen Cs, meaning that NATO will have a total of about 100 Gripens in its inventory. Getting a flight in a fast jet like Gripen is like nothing else. It doesn't matter how many things you read or talk about with pilots, experiencing it firsthand is something completely different. Now, I could tell you about performance, maneuverability, loadout options, and more. But let's be honest, you know those things, and playing top trumps doesn't really tell us anything. For me, flying on Gripen gave me two big takeaways. The first one is how modern fighter jets allow the pilot to gain time and invest this into what matters, the fight and the mission. The second ties into this, and that is how do you design a jet to absorb, process, synthesize, translate massive amounts of data into a clear threat and situation awareness picture for the pilot to execute their mission. One of the best things a fast jet can do is make a pilot stop worrying about the flying and start loving the mission. It's a quest about gaining time. Less time spent on controls, more time spent on building up situational awareness, staying on top of the threat picture, and acting instead of reacting. A modern fighter jet practically flies itself. Yes, yes, that statement does a major disservice to the engineers, the coders, the technicians. After all, it is thanks to them that this plane cuts through the air as smooth as a hot knife through butter.
And regarding roll maneuverability, you can see out to the right here, when we're doing quick rolls, like this, and we're following a terrain line, that's quite nice.
It is hard to describe, but when the controls are this crisp and precise, it feels like it is too easy, bestowing immediate and ultimate confidence in the machine. When I got my stick time in Gripen, it was so easy that it made me think like I was missing something obvious, some hidden challenge in the controls, a soon-to-materialize complication. But it never came.
Your control.
My control. Oh, let's just do a lazy right-hand turn, I guess.
Yep. I mean,
it's almost like it's too easy.
It's too easy, almost. Because a fighter aircraft should be really, really easy to fly.
Yeah.
Because you're supposed to do other stuff. Make smart decisions, maneuver the system, be effective, be fully situation awareness. And that will take a lot of capacity for the pilots.
Stay from you're clear at 280 and below.
280 and below. Actually,
22. It's very easy to start pulling G's, like you mentioned in the briefing.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I just I also really enjoy the view from up here.
It's amazing.
With the clouds.
We will go low in this area in a couple of minutes.
Awesome. Super easy.
Yeah.
It almost feels like in a simulator.
Yeah, it is. Today is really smooth air also.
Yeah.
And now we could try actually by you flying the autopilot. So if you using the pedals, you could do, for example, a left rudder input with your left pedal, just push it.
Pushing it.
Yeah. In altitude hold, you're controlling the grip and by using the pedals.
Oh, okay.
So by doing that, that will free you both hands to do tactical stuff and pay attention to other things.
The simplicity, it keeps the pilot's head up, looking at the fight rather than down to check on the aircraft. You want pilots to invest time, both in training and in a combat scenario, on the mission and the fight, not the actual aircraft. Fighter jets are at the leading edge of the technological curve. The systems installed are always complex. You can answer this challenge by either training more for the machine rather than on the machine, or you condense systems into automated and ergonomic packages that minimize time spent head down. This is especially so as pilots operate complex tactical maneuvers at speed under G loads, which, having experienced it, is a real challenge.
And roll.
Constantly flying high and low, this impacts tactical options, how you lob your missiles, how you outmaneuver at BVR range, or how you mask yourself on a deck against enemy radar, or operate synergetically with other aircraft.
Here's point 9, and we're still not flying tactical, because we're allowed down to 100 feet over land.
Okay. Wow. That was good.
it's just a nice feeling, low-G loop.
And then you run from one mission point to the other at supersonic speed and fulfill a different mission set at each point.
Okay, so let's take a look on the left a short while. This is like a rocket.
Oh, yeah. You can just see the horizon as a straight line.
Yep, and we roll over and we smoothly will go back. Okay, 1.08 right now. You can see that.
Yeah.
Technological leaps happen time and time again. Just think of the 1930s to 1940s, where hydraulic and electric systems, and engine automation substituted mechanical and manual labor for pilots. Pilots could concentrate on the dogfight rather than constantly manipulating controls. In the 1960s, planes got so complicated again, a weapon system officer was added just to manage the weapons, before we were able to condense the complexity back to a single crew member. In Western systems, we see a constant emphasis on simplification for the pilot's benefit. This allows a pilot to manage their jet's firepower package so effectively, it would make a World War II air marshal blush.
So basically it comes with two within visual range missiles, IR tracking, and four radar tracking missiles.
Yeah, in the shallow delta we don't have the IR tracking regarding the weapon, but in the Gripen E we have the IR tracker as a sensor also.
Yeah, okay.
But in this version we could have four BVR missiles and two VVR missiles, a full gun.
Gripen isn't the only example, but it does time management very, very well. Not only does its simplicity on the ground gain time in an operational context through short turnarounds and easy maintenance, but it was one of the first to do away with the old school cockpit gauges, simplifying around three main screens in Gripen C, so Charlie, and one large wide angle display in Gripen E, Echo. What appears strange at first, after all, where is my six pack, does become an intuitive solution on closer inspection. The whole display is optimized for the mission, building up that situational awareness before takeoff and throughout the mission.
If I'm joining a fight in another part of Sweden, I could go there with my map, still standing still during refueling, zoom in into the fight and see how it's going on with the friends or foes before I'm going into the field.
Yeah, you get some situational awareness already. Yeah.
And here, we now need to look at how data is processed. There is a decision-making model that is deeply connected to Air Forces thanks to its origins with John Boyd, an American fighter pilot. It is called the ODA loop. You probably heard about it. And it describes how we make decisions. The challenge here is to get ahead of the adversary's loop, or to put it more simply, the pilot who sees first, thinks first, decides first, shoots first, wins.
In the HUD, in the HCAM that you have in the replica back there in the left display, my prioritize what kind of target I'm looking at will be shown here. And if I'm using a helmet mounted display, it will be pointed out in my helmet itself.
But then you don't actually have to look down.
No. So I could track, if I see something, I could just lock visually and put away my VVR missile. Now it's a green weapon engagement zone. That's meaning, okay, you have a clear shot. We are a little bit slow in speed, but that's okay. I will engage him. And we have a Fox 3. 31 seconds until it will be active. Mm-hmm. Yeah, nowadays the distances, it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
We can see mode 3 squawking 0753. It's handover. I'm making a left turn. Now it's active, so it's guiding himself. And you can say time to impact 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And we have a hit.
Okay.
So that was a clean shot. So just go to another one and directly, bang, one more.
Oh, it's already off. Okay.
Yeah, so Fox 3 on that one.
So you were tracking those two at the same time, engaged one and then the second one.
Handover.
I can guide four at the same time.
Four at the same time, wow.
With shots.
Okay.
Ten targets in total, prioritized. But we have many, many more that the system will track at all times.
Okay.
But I'm paying extra attention to some targets, and then I'm able to shoot four at the same time, different locations.
Fighter jets receive an enormous amount of data, thanks to passive and active radar, data links, communication, ground controllers, and all of this in a contested electronic warfare environment. In its raw form, it's unmanageable. This data needs to be captured, analyzed, processed, and then displayed to the pilot accurately without overloading or missing vital information. This has been a challenge for decades, but now we are entering a phase where only a few people so far really know how the story might unfold.
And if you start to talk to those people,
they will always stay on a very abstract level. So let's condense this together in a way that I understand it, keeping in mind, of course, that it will only be in the coming decade, really, where we will see some tangible results in the public domain. A few years ago, the buzzword sensor fusion really got going. And now we are seeing emphasis placed on instantaneously adaptive processing, like, well, AI-assisted mission datasets. Yeah, depending on how things go, watch for buzzwords like that in the coming years. But what it means is that we are focusing on data processing and translation as a weapon in itself, rather than solely as a means to fire a missile. Sampling data from engagements can lead to machine-assisted projection of what adversary pilots might do and presenting this to the pilots to then make decisions. This doesn't mean that pilots should be reliant on the machine, but it gives them a supporting tool by which adversary patterns and capabilities are fed into the decision-making loop. A arguably early and already existing example of this is like displayed threat zones that show adversary missile angles, right? It doesn't decide for the pilot on how to fight, but it does inform them. In the future, data libraries making patterned predictions can place pilots one step ahead of the adversary. Yet as technology like this is integrated into fighters, it does require major avionics and system modularity that not every plane has. While much nowadays is plug and play, we know how much a plane needs to be designed for or reworked for such capabilities by looking at planes like F-35 or Gripen E, or Echo. Gripen E looks like the same plane as Gripen C, but it's not, it's a completely different aircraft. Which is also sadly the reason why I was never allowed to sit inside a real Gripen E. But even beyond the jet in the air, there are major benefits. Jets don't just absorb data, but gather it, which can be then directly shared and provided updates to data libraries on the force level. And thus a whole air force can very quickly adapt to new adversary tactics, operational patterns, and new threats. While a human must be in the loop, using data in a predictable way allows us to disseminate actionable information, support pilots during missions, and inform tactical decisions. It frees up headspace for the mission with a tool that provides support to be one step ahead of the adversary. As someone told me before the flight, you never know how you are going to react. You know, I didn't scream, I didn't sing, I didn't even remember that the camera was there. That doesn't make for the typical YouTube pumped up action viewing, but for me it was a pure, viscerally stimulating yet analytical sensation where I just wanted to learn and understand the thing I had been studying for so many years and present that to you. Now, flying on Gripen was a humbling experience. It put a lot of things I had read about into context and provided new perspectives on things I basically took for granted. And also, in full honesty, it really showed me not just the limits of my current understanding of fast jet ops, but made me really appreciate even more the sort of level of skill, training, and character that is required to really fly sustained high-level fast jet operations. A massive thank you here to Saab, Andre, and, well, you know who you are, as well as you, of course, the military aviation history community and the patrons and channel supporters who make this possible. You follow the channel, you make it grow, you provide feedback, and you fund research and filming trips. At the end of the day, we're all just like-minded aviation nerds talking about our passion here, but without you, this channel would not be where it is and where I want to take you next. No, but it was really nice. Like above the clouds, amazing.
Almost
the clear skies, yeah. Doing barrel rolls. Shouldn't have done that, but we did. It was really, really low on the deck as well.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
frozen lakes and everything.
Oh, wow.
And then a looping. Can we do this again?